Extensive scholarly training in the psychology of influence, together with 25 years of research into the subject, has earned Dr. Robert B. Cialdini an international reputation as an expert in the fields of persuasion, compliance, and negotiation. He is currently Regents Professor of Psychology at Arizona State University, where he has also been named Distinguished Graduate Research Professor. Dr. Cialdini's book, Influence, which was a result of nearly 3 years of study into the reasons that people comply with requests in business settings, has appeared in numerous editions and many languages. Dr. Cialdini has been invited to share his knowledge of the influencing process with such organizations as Merrill Lynch, Harvard University, IBM, Wells Fargo, Ericsson, Coca-Cola, Stanford University, Bayer Corporation, the Stockholm School of Economics, and Lucent Technologies. Tom Peter says about Dr. Cialdini's book, Influence, the best and the best research book ever on this topic. In fact, the Harvard Business Review has listed his research in their Breakthrough Ideas for Today's Business Agenda. Let's listen together now to hear what he has to say.
As you could probably tell from that introduction, I am primarily an academic. Now, I realize that a purely academic approach is not always held in the highest regard outside of the university community, because academics are forever making theoretical assumptions that may not apply in practice. In fact, I was at a business conference a while ago where I heard a speaker define a theorist as someone who's willing to assume anything except responsibility. Well, I think that's regrettably true, so I'm going to try to be different today. I'll do more than talk about the theory of influence. I want to talk about the practice of influence, how it's possible for one person to significantly increase the likelihood that someone else will say yes to a request, not by changing the merits of the request at all, not by changing what is offered or suggested or recommended, but by changing the way the merits are presented, merely by changing the wording of the presentation. That allows us an enormously cost-effective approach to increasing our bottom line. We don't have to change our products. We don't have to change our services. We don't have to change our hierarchical organization. We don't have to change the way we hire people. We don't have to fire anyone. We just change the way that we make our presentation of what we have to offer. And that can be remarkably effective. I'm going to show you, for example, how by simply changing the way that we stress a particular feature of what we have to offer, or a particular way that we offer a product or service, we can increase the willingness of people to say yes to that request by 300, 400, sometimes 600%. Okay, now how do I plan to come through on this guarantee that I'm going to make about this kind of change? Well, one thing that I'm going to do is talk about a specific kind of influence that I want to consider. I want to talk about the compliance process, the tendency of one person to comply with a request of another. You can change a lot of things about a person. You can persuade a person to change his attitude or her opinion or her perspective on the situation or his beliefs. All of those things are fine, but they all seem to me to occur in the service of changing a person's behavior. So what we're really going to focus on in this program is changing someone's behavior by how it is that we make a request of that individual. Well, where does the information that I'm going to talk about come from? It really comes from two places. The first is more than 50 years now of research into the psychology of persuasion that has been done by social scientists of one sort or another, focusing on the ways in which one person can increase the likelihood that another will say yes by changing the persuasive appeal that is made and that is offered to that person. A lot of that research was done in laboratory settings, scientifically conducted, rigorously controlled research. That's one source of the information. And it's a vast source of information that I'll try to abstract so that we talk about the most powerful and prevalent influences on the influence process as developed from 50 years now of hard social science into the question. The other place that I'm going to look to for evidence is something more personal. It's my own research program. Several years ago, I decided to get outside of the university environment and the laboratories where a lot of this research comes from, and to go into the field where the influence wars are being fought every day, after all. There are professions and there are practitioners within those professions whose business it is to get others to say yes to them, whose economic livelihood depends on the success of the strategies that they use to get others to comply with their requests. So I thought, they must know what works. I mean, there's a law not unlike survival of the fittest that assures it. Those individuals who use persuasive strategies that don't work will not be influence professionals for long. The great hand of the marketplace will sweep them away. They'll be doing something else. But those who use strategies and tactics and principles and practices that are effective will not only thrive, they will flourish, and they will pass their knowledge of the successful strategies on to succeeding generations of influence professions in their training programs. The training programs seem to me to be the one place where the accumulated wisdom of all of the influence professions of our society would be concentrated and transmitted to new members of those professions. So I began to answer ads in the newspaper to take training in as many of the influence professions of our society as I could get access to. I began by learning how to sell automobiles from a lot, by selling insurance from an office, by selling portrait photography over the phone. I was the guy from Olin Mills. I was that guy. I didn't stop there, though. I also infiltrated a couple of advertising agencies. What do the most effective copywriters load into their messages that moves people in the direction of the products and services that they are advertising and promoting? I did the same thing with a charity organization. What do the fundraisers do that successfully causes people to give to charities, to donate, to contribute to one cause or another? I looked at what recruiters do. How about armed service recruiters? What do the most effective of them do when they get those kids to sign on the dotted line for 2, 3, 4 years of their lives? I even interviewed cult recruiters. What do the cults do that so powerfully pulls people in, holds them in their organizations? And across it all, I looked for the commonalities. Which were the things that occurred in parallel in each of these influence professions that caused people to say yes wherever they were employed? I figured that must be the evidence that I'm looking for of what are the most powerful influences on the influence process in our society. I did that for about 2.5 years, and what I found surprised me in 3 ways. The first surprise was that I only counted 6 universal principles of influence, principles that, if they were present in a request, significantly increased the likelihood that people would say yes to that request, wherever they were employed. We'll talk about all 6 of those principles in the program that we're talking with you about today. The second surprise that I got was that even though these principles would be best characterized as the optimal approaches to the influence process, not everyone was using them optimally. I thought I could count 3 kinds of agents of influence. There are bunglers of influence, there are smugglers of influence, and then there are sleuths of influence or detectives of influence. Let's take each one in turn. The bungler of influence is the kind of person who fumbles away the opportunity to use one or another of these powerful influence principles because he or she doesn't know what the principles are or doesn't know how to engage them, how to commission them so that all will benefit. And so the bungler fumbles away opportunities that are right there in the situation, waiting to be employed. I hope that by the end of this program, you will be significantly less likely to be a bungler of the influence process. Well, let's take an example of how that might work. A few years ago, I was doing some speaking overseas in Australia. It was a big group, about 300 people in the audience. But there was a man in the third row who, as I began talking about one of the fundamental universal principles of influence, began to look ill. His face blanched white, his hand began to tremble, and I thought there was something wrong, so I stopped things and I asked him if he was okay, and he said, "Yeah, I'm all right, but I just recognized something I never realized before." He said, "I own a small scale but still profitable software company here in Sydney. But a while ago, a few years ago, our major customer was located in Melbourne. They were the majority of our business at that time. And so when they called to say that they had a problem with some of our software, not only did I send my most experienced technician, I sent two of my most experienced technicians, and I went along with them just to assure that we would dispatch this problem immediately. That's how important these people were to our business at that time. And it turned out it was a relatively minor thing. We were able to take care of it in the course of a morning, and that afternoon we were sitting in the office of the IT director, and she said to me, "Thank you. I want to tell you something. You showed me a kind of commitment that I rarely see. I appreciate what you've done. Not only did you send your most experienced technician, you sent two of them, and you came along with them. That shows me something. That was above and beyond the call of duty. So I very much appreciate it." And he said, "I heard the following words come out of my mouth. I said, 'Oh, don't think anything of it. It was no big thing. I would have done it for anybody, just part of the job.'" And he said, "I saw her face fall. And I didn't quite know what to do. So I tried adding something else. I compounded the problem by saying, 'Oh, and you know, we love to come to Melbourne whenever we can. The nightlife here, the theater, the restaurants, we come to Melbourne whenever we can arrange it.'" He said, "Her face turned to stone. And we have never, ever gotten another piece of business from that company. And now I recognize why. I bungled something away that was right there in the situation. She had just been grateful to me. She had just expressed a feeling of obligation for what I had just done. And I swatted it away. I waved it away, and it wasn't even true. It wasn't the case that we would do this for anybody. We did this because they were our special business partners. And so I fumbled away the opportunity to use that powerful moment of influence." And he was exactly right. There was a moment of power that he was afforded immediately after this woman said thank you. And it's a moment of power we are all given when we have done something very right, when we have provided services or products that have made people happy with what we have offered them. And in that moment after thank you, we need to do something. We can't just fumble it away. I'm going to talk about what we can do in that moment, but first I want to talk about the second kind of influence professional besides the bungler who we just talked about. There's the smuggler of influence. This is the person who does know what these six principles are, does know how to commission them in his or her behalf, but who imports them dishonestly into a situation where they don't naturally reside, and then exploits their power so that only one person in the situation wins, and that is the agent of influence. The person who is the target of influence is exploited and loses in the bargain. The problem with that approach, besides it being unethical, which is a big problem that we surely want to steer clear of, the problem of unethical approaches to the business world, because these are our partners, after all. These are the people who we want to be in a relationship with for the long term. And if we exploit or abuse their interests in any influence situation, that's going to come back and bite us practically, but it's also the wrong thing to do just ethically. Now, besides the ethical problem associated with the smuggler's approach, there's a practical problem as well, and that is one of the parties loses. The person who was tricked into compliance doesn't get the best set of products or services. They were dishonestly steered in a particular direction. And as a consequence, that person is unlikely to want to return to any interaction, to any setting where their outcomes have been poor. I'll give you an example of one such situation. Suppose you want to buy a computer system for your home. You go to a retail store and you meet one of the salespeople and you describe the needs that you have for a system in your home, the kinds of things that you really want. And this person says, I know exactly the system for you. In fact, I have a system just like this one because I have the same kinds of needs that you do. And this has been a great system for me. Let me recommend this one. Well, that's a kind of influence approach using the principle of authority or expertise that can be very powerful. However, in this instance, if this individual, this salesperson, was a smuggler of the influence process, it might be that that was not the computer system that he or she owned. It happened to be the computer system that provided the greatest commission that week for selling it because there was a special deal with the manufacturer. And that's why this salesperson recommended that system. And if that was the case, sure, there would be a short-term benefit. The customer would likely purchase that system. But because it wouldn't be right for the customer, that customer would be unlikely to refer neighbors or friends or family members to that particular store or to that particular salesperson, be unlikely to return for future systems and so on. And so while the smuggler's approach is short-term success, it's long-term disaster. And we can't do anything that increases the likelihood that people will say yes to us at time one that simultaneously decreases the likelihood that people will say yes to us at time two and three and four and five. And in modern business, what we're talking about is the long term. That's the way to profitability. The short term is the wrong-headed approach. So what is the best approach? We've talked about the bungler, certainly. That's not the approach. We're suggesting the smuggler is hardly the right approach for ethical and practical reasons. It's the third kind of influence agent who I'm going to recommend. It's the sleuth of influence, the detective of influence, the person who goes into every situation armed with the knowledge of what the six principles are and who looks for the presence of one or another of these powerful principles that exists naturally there in the situation. So the task for the sleuth is to uncover one or another of these principles, not to manufacture or fabricate its presence there, but to reveal it, to point it out, to make it more prominent in consciousness of the people who the sleuth is trying to convince. And in that way, alert people to the presence of one of these principles that will steer them correctly if it is a natural part of the situation. In this way, we inform people into yes. We don't trick them. We don't coerce them into yes. We educate them into taking a step that's going to be in their best interests. And that's the approach that I will recommend. Now, let's go back to that situation that I described in Australia, where that man was sitting in the IT director's office and had just been complimented and thanked for his efforts in solving this problem. What could he have said in that moment after thank you that would have been more successful than what he wound up saying that not only was unsuccessful, it was negative, it had a boomerang effect in causing that company never to do business with his again? What could he have said? Well, I have a couple of suggestions that you might think about. One is to say, well, of course, we were glad to do it. You are a valued customer of ours. This is the sort of thing you can expect us to do in the future. And of course, that's true. That's true. He could have just raised that to the surface and said it and leveraged the influence of that moment well beyond the situation. Instead, he said something else about, oh, we do this for anybody. And it wasn't even true. He was just trying to be courteous. He let the moment evaporate. Another thing he could have said, which I think is even better, is something like, well, of course, this is what long-term partners do for one another. You see, by saying it that way, he establishes the partnership between the two of them. And that partnership is something that works both ways, so that what he has established is the sense that, of course, we're a long-term partner of you. We're glad to do this. But the subtext of that message is also, and you are our long-term partner. So when we need something from you, it's only fair that we could ask for it as well in return for the benefits that we provide you. See, it's important when thinking about these issues not just to be talking about giving, 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 but what do we receive as a result of providing excellent service or products or efforts in behalf of the people that we deal with, our partners. We have to put on record the fact that a partnership is an exchange, and when we might need an invoice turned around quickly, we can ask for those kinds of favors, and our long-term partners will want to give back to us as well. And if we set the stage in that way, we leverage our influence well into the future. Okay, well, that's the sleuth's approach that I'm going to recommend. Now, I've suggested that there were three surprises that I got in studying the influence process in this way. And let me tell you about the third surprise. It was that even though I decided to study the aces of the influence process, the people whose performance outdid everyone else in their organization, the top scorers in their groups, I wanted to look at what differentiated them from the more mediocre performers. And wouldn't you think that anyone whose business it was to get others to say yes to their requests would spend a lot of time structuring the request that they made, what they said in making their appeal for change? That's what I thought. But what I found was that the top performers spent more time in what they did and said immediately before making their request than they did on the request itself. In other words, they created a psychological context into which they could then place a request and people would be responsive to it because of what they had done first. They had cultivated the ground for the seeds that they then sowed for change. But that cultivation occupied more of their time than it did for their less successful cousins in the process of sales and management. So let's talk a little bit about what a person could do to create a favorable context for change. The six principles that we're going to talk about can be viewed as establishing, each one establishes a certain kind of favorable context for change.